ஓகே, ஆக்சுவல் பல்மெரடிமா ஃபஸ்ட்டு டெஃபினேஷன் நம்ம எல்லாருக்கும் தெரிஞ்சது தான். இன்ட்ராவாஸ்குலர் கம்பார்ட்மெண்ட்டில் இருந்து வாட்டர் வந்து என்ட்ரிங் இன் டு தி ஆல்வியோலை அண்ட் தி இன்டர்ஸ்டிஷியம் ஆஃப் தி லங், அதுதான் வந்து பல்மெரடிமா. நார்மலாக தே வி ஹவ் த்ரீ ப்ரொடெக்டிவ் மெக்கானிசம் டு ப்ரிவெண்ட் பல்மெரி எம்பாலியம் பல்மெரி எடிமா. அந்த த்ரீ ப்ரொடெக்டிவ் மெக்கானிசம்ஸ் என்னென்ன அப்படின்னா, ஒன்று வந்து ஆல்வியோலார் கேபிலரி பேரியர், இட் வில் பி அ டைட் பேரியர், இட் ஒன்ட் அலோவ் த வாட்டர் டு பாஸ் த்ரூ. அண்ட் ஆல்சோ வி ஹவ் இன்டர்ஸ்டிஷியல் லிம்ஃபேட்டிக்ஸ், அண்ட் தென் வி ஹவ் இன்க்ரீஸ்டு ப்ரோட்டீன் இன் தி இன்ட்ராவாஸ்குலர் கம்பார்ட்மெண்ட். ஸோ தேர் வில் பி ஹை ஆன்கோட்டிக் ப்ரெஷர், தட் இஸ் பிளாஸ்மா ஆன்கோட்டிக் ப்ரெஷர். நார்மலி திஸ் இஸ் தி ஆல்வியோலை, இப் இட் இஸ் இஃப் திஸ் இஸ் அ பல்மரி கேபிலரி, அண்ட் திஸ் ஒன் வில் பி த இன்டர்ஸ்டிஷியம். We have more proteins, so plasma oncotic pressure is very high, so it won't allow the water to go through. And also in the interstitium we have interstitial lymphatics, even if the water comes here it will get absorbed. And also we have alveolar epithelium tight junctions, so it also won't allow the water to pass through into the alveoli. So these are the three protective mechanisms to prevent pulmonary edema. Normally from right atrium to the right ventricle if the blood flows via the pulmonary artery. Okay, here comes the alveoli, it forms the pulmonary capillaries and then pulmonary veins and then into the left atrium. Okay, this is the artery, this is a pulmonary vein, pulmonary capillary. From pulmonary artery to pulmonary vein the hydrostatic pressure will keep decreasing and the plasma oncotic pressure will keep increasing. So at the end of pulmonary artery we have high hydrostatic pressure and then a low plasma oncotic pressure. At the end of pulmonary vein we have low hydrostatic pressure, high plasma oncotic pressure. So because of this, at the end of pulmonary artery the water will goes out to the interstitium. The water will goes out to the interstitium and then gas exchange will takes place and then it reaches the vein. Here there is high plasma oncotic pressure, so water will comes in. But won't be the 100% water won't come, some 90-95, remaining 5% will be absorbed by, 5 to 10% will be absorbed by interstitial lymphatics. This is how it works on. In case of pulmonary edema, if there is a change in this imbalance between these forces, that is at the end of the pulmonary vein, if the hydrostatic pressure increases or the plasma oncotic pressure decreases or the interstitial negative pressure increases, which leads to pulmonary edema. That is a pathophysiology of pulmonary edema can be because of imbalance in the Starling's force. That is a increased hydrostatic pressure at the pulmonary veins and capillaries, decreased plasma oncotic pressure, and then increased negative interstitial pressure. So it will sucks the water. And other causes like alveolar epithelial barrier injury, sorry, alveolar capillary barrier injury. If any lymphatic obstructions and other miscellaneous causes. So only this increased hydrostatic pressure at the end of pulmonary vein is because of cardiac cause. It is called as cardiogenic pulmonary edema. All other mechanisms are considered as non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. That is ARDS. So coming to topic proper, we are going to first discuss about cardiogenic pulmonary edema. As I said earlier, it is because of increased hydrostatic pressure at the pulmonary capillaries. So the water will ultimately moves on to the interstitium and then into the alveoli, causing pulmonary edema. Increase in the hydrostatic pressure is mainly because of left heart disease. So etiology will be, can be remembered as CHAMP or champion. C for coronary syndrome, that is ACS, acute coronary syndrome. It's the most common cause for acute pulmonary edema. This MA can be associated with ventricular septal rupture, RV free wall rupture, and then as we know, papillary muscle rupture, all these things. And then H for hypertensive emergencies. And then A for arrhythmias. Arrhythmias can be tachyarrhythmias or bradyarrhythmias. That is a refractory tachy and bradyarrhythmias. It can be supraventricular or ventricular arrhythmias. And then aortic dissection. And then M for mechanical causes, like critical MS and AS, acute AR and MR, and then any left atrial myxoma like that. Other M's will be myocarditis, cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, all these things. And then P will be pulmonary embolism, and then post cardiac arrest, all those things. And then drugs. Drugs can be heroin, cocaine, beta blocker and calcium channel blocker, overdose, salicylate poisoning, thiazolidine ions, all those things will cause cardiogenic pulmonary edema. All these things at the end point will increases the left atrial pressure, left atrial filling pressure, thereby which increases the pulmonary venous pressure. It's going to increase the pulmonary capillary hydrostatic pressure. Invariably, it's going to cause pulmonary edema. It is the etiologies of cardiogenic pulmonary edema. In all these conditions, there is heart failure. That is imbalance between the demand and supply. Demand is not equal to supply. Since left atrial pressure is increased, anyhow, the blood coming to the LV will be decreased. So ultimately, the cardiac output will be decreased. So end organ perfusion will be decreased, like brain, kidney, and liver. Also, because of increase in left atrial pressure, increase in pulmonary venous pressure, it's going to cause pulmonary edema. That is congestion. Even if it extends further, it is going to cause systemic congestion. Raised JVP, hepatomegaly, and ankle edema. So heart failure and pulmonary edema goes hand in hand. Acute decompensated heart failures are usually present with acute cardiogenic pulmonary edema. So we want to discuss about heart failure. Stages in heart failure, according to ACC. Stage one are patients at risk for heart failure. Those patients won't have heart failure, but have the risk factors like hypertension and diabetes. Stage two are asymptomatic heart failure. These patients have the signs of heart failures, but they won't be symptomatic, like raised JVP or ankle edema like that. And they also have some structural heart disease. And then stage three will be symptomatic heart failure. These patients are whom we are seeing coming to our OP emergency with the acute pulmonary edema, breathlessness, apnea, BND. And then stage four are the people who are already under treatment, but they are refractory and are at the end stage. These are the stages of heart failure. So some patients with the heart failure suddenly presenting to us with pulmonary edema might be because of some triggers. We want to identify the triggers and we want to treat the triggers also. The triggers can affect previously normal heart or previously structural heart disease heart, but without heart failure. Or this trigger can also affect the already heart failure patients, but they are compensated. They are
hello ji,
very much normal. Already structural heart disease but without any heart failure or heart failure patients with well compensated, with well compensated, the triggers can affect the normal heart, already structural heart disease but without any heart failure, or heart failure patients with well compensated, the triggers can affect the normal heart, already structural heart disease but without any heart failure, or heart failure patients with well compensated, the triggers can be if it's going to affect the normal heart, it is usually myocarditis. The triggers can be, if it's going to affect the normal heart, it is usually myocarditis, acute myocarditis causing acute LVF and causing pulmonary edema. If it is in the structural heart disease, the triggers can be acute coronary syndrome or arrhythmias, or it can be anemia. Can remember it as AQ. In case of compensated heart failure, it can be because of mainly poor compliance to drugs. And then dietary restrictions, increased fluid intake, and then increased salt intake, and then sepsis. High output states like thyrotoxicosis, beriberi. And then drug overdose. All those things are going to cause the decompensation. Once the decompensation occurs, four amplifier mechanisms will also happen hand in hand. It is going to further worsen the condition. Amplifier mechanisms. First one will be neurohormonal. This is because in compensation, there will be decreased cardiac output. As a compensatory mechanism, neurohormonal activation will occur. It will further going to worsen the condition. Neurohormonal includes ROS overactivity, sympathetic nervous system overactivity, and also inflammation and free radical injury. Because of this, we are prescribing ACE inhibitors and beta blockers for the heart failure patients to prevent this. And the second amplifier mechanism is vascular. Vascular remodeling will occur, which includes increased arterial stiffness and volume redistribution. This redistribution will differ for patient to patient. The volume will be more in pulmonary for few patients, more in vascular for few patients. If it is in vascular, those patients will present with the hypertension predominantly. Those in pulmonary will present with congestion predominantly. And also there will be capillary leakage. And also afterload contractility mismatch. These are the vascular changes. And the changes occurring in the kidney, AKI, which we usually call as caudate renal syndrome, and also ROS overactivity, and also sodium and water retention. And the changes in the myocardium. This is the important one. Because it's going to affect the heart. Already there is a ischemia or infarct which has precipitated this decompensated heart failure. Because of sympathetic nervous system activity, there will be tachy, which further increases the demand, resulting in a further ischemia, so leading to myocardial necrosis, fibrosis, and also decreased cardiac output, and also ventricular interdependence. That is, if the LV diastolic filling pressure is high, it's going to push the ventricular septum to the right side. So it's going to affect the right heart filling pressure, right heart filling also. So right heart failure occurs because of left heart failure. Similarly, in case of right heart failure, if there is a right ventricle diastolic filling pressure is high, the ventricular septum will be pushed to the left. So it will affect the left heart diastolic filling. So it will result in right heart diastolic dysfunction. So of course, the amount of blood coming to the left atrium will be decreased. So further resulting in decrease in cardiac output. So these are the four changes. At last, all these four changes like vascular, neurohormonal, renal, and myocardium, all these four results in congestion and end organ dysfunction. That is because of decreased cardiac output. End organ dysfunction in brain, liver, and kidney. Congestion can be pulmonary or systemic. Based on this congestion and end organ dysfunction, we classify heart failure as four types. We commonly know like wet and warm. Wet and warm means congestion is there, but the cardiac output is still maintained. The patient feels warm. So these patients, how we are going to treat? Wet means there is definitely pulmonary edema is there, but the patient still feels warm. They can be divided into hypertensive predominant or congestion predominant, as I already said, because of a redistribution of the intravascular volume. It will differ to patient to patient. If it is hypertension predominant, we want to give vasodilators and diuretics. If it is congestion predominant, we are going to give vasodilators, diuretics. If it is resistant, we have to go for ultrafiltration. Ultrafiltration is nothing but removing the isotonic fluid, sodium and water, using large bore venous vessels. And then if the patient is wet and cold, that means the cardiac output is also decreased and also there is pulmonary congestion, then we have to check for SBP, systolic blood pressure, if it is less than 90 or more than 90. If it is less than 90, we can't give diuretics. Even though the patient is wet, we can't give diuretics. So we have to start with inotropes. And then we can go with vasoactive agents like vasopressin or noradrenaline. In case of refractory cases, even then the BP is less. We have mechanical circulatory support, which includes intra-aortic balloon pump, veno-arterial or veno-venous, ECMO, extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. These are the temporary measures. And then at last, once the BP is improved, we can go with the diuretics. If the SBP is more than 90, we can go with diuretics and vasodilator. Still, if there is cold, we have to start on inotropes. And then patients who are dry, that is no congestion, and warm, cardiac output is also good. Those patients usually won't come to us. Those patients only need change in their oral drugs, just to adjust the drugs. There is no decompensation. They are well and good. They may go for decompensation in future. Dry and cold. Dry and cold means there is no congestion, but cardiac output is decreased. So in these cases, we have to give fluid challenge, since there is no wet, only dry, but under careful monitoring of central venous pressure. If there is no response, we have to go with inotropes. Okay. In heart failure patients, the insult or index event will occur here. Patient will be asymptomatic initially and then become symptomatic. EF will be 60% initially. It will decrease to 20%. So some secondary changes will occur. And then the compensatory mechanism will regain it. It's a dilatation of the ventricle. Secondary changes occur. Again, the compensatory mechanism will restore the function. If the index event is reversible, if the index event is irreversible, then the compensatory mechanism won't work. It will keep on worsening. At some point, it will develop symptomatic heart failure. With all this treatment, after dividing into four categories, again, we have something called a clinical congestion and hemodynamic congestion. Clinical congestion are those patients who are presenting to us with pulmonary edema. We give diuretics and we treat them. Clinical congestion will be removed. Hemodynamic congestion means it's the preceding stage of clinical congestion. Hemodynamic congestion means left ventricular diastolic filling pressure. It will be remains high. Even after treating with diuretics, the patient's symptoms will be relieved. Even then, LV diastolic filling pressure remains high. So it will affect the ventricular interdependence, as I said earlier, further worsens the heart failure. It will be keep going. It will be keep progressing. We can't control that. So always there will be hemodynamic congestion. next moving on to stages of pulmonary edema. As I already said, pulmonary edema may occurs mainly because of increased hydrostatic pressure at the pulmonary veins or pulmonary capillaries because of LV, sorry, left-sided heart disease. So, if it is an interstitium, it is a pulmonary capillary alveoli. Because of increased hydrostatic pressure, it is capillaries are distended. The fluid initially, because of rise in pressure, there will be pulmonary congestion. This is stage one. No fluid will move to interstitium and alveoli, only pulmonary congestion. So gas exchange will occur normally in stage one. This excess fluid will be absorbed by interstitial lymphatics. Since we have three protective mechanism, one already gone, plasma oncotic pressure, but the other two are intact. Interstitial lymphatics will try to remove the fluid as much as possible. So because of pulmonary congestion, in X-ray, we will have cephalization. Because of pulmonary congestion, that is our increased intravascular volume, the redistribution of blood will occur predominantly towards the apex. Usually there will be less blood going to the apex, but if there is a pulmonary congestion and dilatation of the pulmonary vessels, cephalization occurs. In stage two, the hydrostatic pressure exceeds the plasma oncotic pressure, that is 25 centimeter of water. Here it is around, in stage one, it is around 50 to 20, but it's still less than plasma oncotic pressure. So the fluid can't reach the interstitium, but here it exceeds the plasma oncotic pressure. So it easily enters the interstitium. So it will interfere with the gas exchange. So it can result in hypoxia, but it won't cause tachypnea. And also this pressure is not enough to reach the alveoli. So interstitium is filled with fluids. So interstitial lymphatics will be dilated, right? Since it's going to absorb more fluids. So this dilated interstitial lymphatics, it will called as Curley's B line. That is, it's an interlobar septa. That's also an interstitium, right? So in X-ray in stage two, we will see Curley's B lines. That's predominantly in the basal areas. From the pleura near the right costophrenic angle. Next, going to stage three. Already cephalization has occurred. In stage one, Curley's B line occurs. In stage three, the pressure, pulmonary capillary, which pressure reaches up to 30 centimeter of water or millimeter of mercury. So now it can reach up to alveoli. But alveolar capillary barrier is still intact. Unless in ARDS, it will be injured. So only fluid can go inside, but not the protein. So it will be transudate, not exudate. So alveoli is flooded with fluids. So patient going to present with pink frothy sputum, hypoxia, tachypnea, dyspnea. So at this stage, if you take X-ray, we have bad wing appearance. Perihilar areas will be full of fluffy opacities. It can be isolated opacities or can be confluent opacities. Opacity is based on the severity. These are the three things. Initially, at the stage one, there will be only cardiomegaly and cephalization of the arteries. In the stage two, there will be Curley's B lines. The arrow pointing towards the Curley's B lines, dilated interstitial lymphatics. And in the stage three, we have typical bad wing appearance. To diagnose heart failure, we have something called a Framingham criteria. It includes major and minor. Major includes 8. It includes PND and pulmonary edema, 2 pieces. And then in relation to JVP, distended neck veins and hepatojugular reflex. And then in response to auscultation, we have S3 gallop. And then bilateral crackles or rails on these. And then in of investigations, we will be having cardiomegaly and pulmonary capillary wedge pressure more than 16 centimeter of water. So total of 8. 2P, 2 in response to pulse, that is JVP, 2 in effect of auscultation, and 2 investigation findings. So total 8. The minor criteria which includes 3 clinical symptoms, that is nocturnal cough, dyspnea on exertion, ankle edema. 2 investigation finding. Usually in USG we get hepatomegaly and pleural effusion, right? That same thing. And the other 2, vital capacity is reduced to 1/3 of maximum capacity, and then tachy. So total 7. 3 symptoms, 2 investigations, and vital capacity and tachy. And something is that it won't belong to major or minor. Wherever you need, you can use it. That is a loss of weight of more than 4.5 kg in 5 days in response to diuretics. So to say heart failure, you should have 2 major or 1 major plus 2 minor. If you have only 1 major and 1 minor, you can use this loss of weight as a minor. If you have only 2 minor and loss of weight, of now you can use loss of weight as major criteria. So all these things we have to check in case of pulmonary edema. To know whether it is cardiogenic pulmonary edema or not, we have to check for all these findings. These are the symptoms and signs which comes under the Framingham's criteria. That is all. The clinical features of pulmonary edema will be like dyspnea, tachypnea, diaphoresis, then pink frothy sputum, nocturnal cough, exertional dyspnea, pedal edema. Then signs like S3 gallop, bilateral basal crackles. And then while checking for BP, we have to look for 2 things: narrow pulse pressure or wide pulse pressure. If it is narrow pulse pressure, there is a decreased cardiac output. If it is wide pulse pressure, we have to rule out the high output cardiac states, which might be an index even. So if there is a wide pulse pressure, look for thyrotoxicosis or AR or anemia, any high output state, which might be a cause for our acute decompensation. So these are the signs and symptoms. And then moving on to investigations of pulmonary edema. As usual, we are going to do CBC to look for sepsis. Sepsis might be an index even or trigger. So raised WBC. CRP will be elevated. And then to look for end organ dysfunction because of decreased cardiac output, look for RFT for urea and creat. And LFT because of hypoperfusion to the liver, OTPT will be raised, can be raised. And then lactate will be increased. We can go for ABG. And then we have to monitor glucose. Admission time glucose is one of the important mortality predictor. So it's a prognostic indicator. And then we will go for X-ray. Chest X-ray already we have seen. In stage 1, there will be cephalization. In stage 2, there will be Kelly's B-line. And in stage 3, there will be bad wing appearance. And in echo. Echo in pulmonary edema. Uses of echo in pulmonary edema can be to find out its etiology. We already mentioned CAMP. So if there is MI, that is acute coronary syndrome, look for regional wall motion abnormality. And also those ventricular septal rupture or free wall rupture or a papillary muscle rupture, all those things. And then myocardium in danger. And how is the non-infect areas? All those things we can check. and for A, acute aortic syndrome, that is any dissection, extent of dissection, all those things we have to look for. Mechanical, as I already said, the valvular heart diseases, acute MR, acute AR, any vegetations, all those things we have to check for. P for pulmonary embolism, right ventricle function, all those things we have to check for. And also cardiac tamponade and dynamic left ventricular outflow obstruction. All those things we have to search for in terms of etiology. Echo will also help us in assessing the hemodynamics by looking at IVC diameter and its compressibility, and also pulmonary artery systolic pressure, all those things. And also it's going to help us therapeutic guidance to choose on inotropes and respond to our therapy. How is the response? And also it's going to say about to decide on mechanical circulatory support. As I already mentioned, if there is a no improvement with the inotropes, they will go with mechanical circulatory support, which includes intra-aortic balloon pump and ECMO, which can be veno-venous or veno-arterial. In pulmonary edema, mostly they use veno-venous. And also to place catheter position, and also for catheter guidance, echo will help. And at last, to look for pleural effusion, pneumothorax, and lung infiltrates, pulmonary infiltrates. It is the role of echo in pulmonary edema. And we will do something called as a pulmonary artery catheterization. That is, we use Swan-Ganz catheter. Indications for it's not going to alter the mortality, but it helps in diagnosis and also in deciding the treatment modality. We are going to insert this Swan-Ganz catheter with via the IJV, going to reach the right atrium and then right ventricle, and then going on to pulmonary artery, pulmonary capillary. We can't go beyond pulmonary capillaries. So we are going to inflate the balloon here. So hence it is called as pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. We are creating a wedge here, and indirectly we are measuring pulmonary venous pressure and the left atrial pressure. So pulmonary capillary pressure is a wedge pressure is indirect measurement of left atrial pressure. So indications for Swan-Ganz catheter insertion is, still we don't know the diagnosis, either it is cardiogenic or non-cardiogenic, because pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, if it is more than 16, it's cardiogenic. If it is less than 16, then it's going to be ARDS, non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. So if we don't know the diagnosis, we can do, if there is no response to treatment, and pulmonary edema with hypotension, all those things are indication for PAC. By pulmonary artery catheterization, we can also check for left to right shunt. In case of ventricular septal rupture, left to right shunt can occur, and also left atrial filling pressure can be measured. So with this, we are going to calculate some hemodynamics. Hemodynamics in pulmonary edema will be right atrial systolic pressure and diastolic pressure can be normal or increased. Right ventricle systolic pressure and right ventricle diastolic pressure will be increased. Similarly, pulmonary artery systolic pressure and pulmonary artery diastolic pressure will be increased. Pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, definitely it's going to be increased more than 16. And cardiac index will be less than 2.5 ml per meter square. It is a cardiac output in response to body surface area. Normally more than 2.5 per ml per meter square. 2.5 per minute per meter square. 2.5 liter per minute per meter square. Here the cardiac index will be decreased. All other things will be increased. That is, it's about 12 to 25. Diastolic, it's about 6 to 2. Same, 12 to 25, 6 to 12. So it is the hemodynamics in pulmonary edema. And then there is something called a tissue Doppler ratio. It's a non-invasive method of roughly calculating pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. If this tissue Doppler ratio, that is E is to EA, If it is more than 16, then the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is also more than 16. E means yearly. Sorry, peak. E means peak yearly diastolic transmitral blood flow velocity. EA means peak yearly diastolic mitral annular tissue velocity. E means peak yearly diastolic transmitral blood flow velocity, and EA means peak yearly diastolic mitral annular tissue velocity. So this ratio, if it is more than 16, then pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is approximately more than 16, then it's a diagnostic of podogenic pulmonary edema. Moving on to management. We have to decrease the preload and also if possible afterload. So first one is positioning. Head and elevation with the leg hanging on the side of the bed will decrease the venous return and thereby decreasing the preload. And then oxygen support. If there is no hypercapnia, only hypoxia, and PaO2 is slightly less than 60, we can go with a venturi or face nasal mask up to 20 liters for over 20 minutes. If there is no improvement or if there is a worsening of sensorium or there is increasing hypercapnia and still the PaO2 is less than 60, we have to change to NIV, non-invasive ventilation. Non-invasive ventilation can be provided as CPAP or a non-invasive intermittent positive pressure ventilation. Non-invasive intermittent positive pressure ventilation is better than CPAP in terms of mortality benefit. Here we are going to keep the PEEP high. By increasing the PEEP, we are going to get three benefits. First one, it's going to decrease the preload. By increasing intrathoracic pressure, it's going to decrease the venous return. So preload is going to decrease. And also it will decrease the afterload. By aortic compression, so because of aortic compression, it activates the baroreceptor complex in the aorta, which decreases the afterload because of parasympathetic activity. Next one, it's going to push the fluid out of the alveoli. That is, our intra-alveolar fluid moves to extra-alveolar compartment. So gas exchange will be regained. Since the gas exchange is going to occur intra-alveoli, so if intra-alveolar fluids are pushed to the extra-alveolar compartment, the gas exchange can be regained. And then it's going to prevent atelectasis by keeping the end expiratory pressure high. We are going to prevent the collapse of the alveoli, thereby preventing atelectasis. By these three mechanisms, it's going to help in pulmonary edema. And then if there is no improvement, we have to go with a mechanical intubation, mechanical ventilation. And then next to oxygen therapy, we have to move on to vasodilators. Vasodilators can be NTG, 5 microgram per minute. Infusion can be given, or sodium nitroprusside, or even ISDN can be given. And then other vasodilators like nesritide. It is a synthetic analog of brine natriuretic peptide. Nesritide is having the capacity of decreasing the preload. It has the capacity of vasodilatation both artery and venous, and also it has the property of natriuresis. So the requirement of diuretics will be decreased if we are going to use nesritide. Nesritide at a dose of 2 microgram per kg per minute bolus, followed by 0.03 microgram per kg per minute. Sorry. Bolus 2 microgram per kg, followed by 0.03 microgram per kg per minute. There is a trial conducted called VMAC, vasodilator in management of acute congestive heart failure. VMAC. They compared the efficacy of a vasodilator. The most efficacious will be nesritide, decreasing the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure within 3 hours. And then moving on to diuretics. Diuretics, we are going to give loop diuretics. If there is no response, we can also add thiazides. Till there is no response, we can add inotropes. That is dopamine and dobutamine. At a dose of 2 microgram per kg per minute to cause renal vasodilatation. So by causing renal vasodilatation, it's going to improve the action of diuretics. And also there is something called ionodilators. That is having the action of both ionotropic action as well as vasodilatory action. It is milrinin. It's a phosphodiesterase 3 inhibitor. But since it has an inotropic action, it's going to increase the LV contraction. So it's going to increase the myocardial oxygen demand. So in case of ACS precipitating pulmonary edema, milrinin cannot be used. Milrinin at a dose of 25 to 75 microgram per kg per minute, per kg over 10 minutes, followed by 0.25 to 0.75 microgram per kg per minute. So it is ionodilator. If there is no response to diuretics, we have to go with ultrafiltration, as I already said. Ultrafiltration is a removal of the isotonic fluid. So it has some advantage over diuretics, that diuretics, if it's going to remove the intravascular fluid, automatically it's going to activate the sympathetic nervous system because of decreased perfusion to the end organs. But here it's going to remove the isotonic fluids. The activation of sympathetic nervous system is less. There is a study called UNLOAD to compare the efficacy of diuretics and ultrafiltration. Ultrafiltration has a maximum weight reduction in 48 hours. And also over the next 90 days, the recurrent admission is also very less. And then we are going to morphine at 2 to 4 mg. It can be, all these things can be remembered as LM and OP. Lasix, morphine, nitrates, oxygen, and then position. Upright posture. Others like AC inhibitors can be tried, which is both the arterial and venous dilator. So it's going to decrease both afterload and preload. At last, to increase the alveolar clearance, we have to activate those ion channels in the alveolar epithelium. Cyclic AMP activators, agonist, are under trials to increase the alveolar clearance. And also we have to identify the trigger or index event. If it is ACS, going for PCA or CABG. If it is arrhythmias, tachyarrhythmias, we have to go for synchronized cardioversion. Based upon the index event, we have to treat the index event also. And then prognosis. There are 3 B's to say the prognosis. In-hospital mortality in pulmonary edema, that is BP, and then blood urea nitrogen, and then brain natriuretic peptide. Patients with high BP have less mortality. That is inversely proportional. Even patients with BP more than 180 have better mortality compared to the patients presenting with shock, pulmonary edema shock. And then blood urea nitrogen, is better than creatinine. It indicates the end organ dysfunction, that is a renal hypoperfusion, and brain arteriovenous peptide. It is increased the prognosis is that. These are the prognostic indicators, and also they have done a study based upon the efficacy of only using diuretics, or we have to use both vasodilators, that is nitrates as well as diuretics. If the patient's BP is less than 100 or 100 to 119, the prognostic significance is very high. That is, the difference is very high. The blue color one is only diuretics. The red color one is vasodilator plus diuretics. The gap is very high. Whereas if the patient's having BP more than 120, more than 160, there is no significant difference between using only diuretics alone or using diuretics plus vasodilators. Moving on to non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema.
ARDS no topic ma'am eduthaanga
bro acher okay appo stop panidema
ARDS
topic ka or moon matter irukke and high altitude adala vandu solluma nam
illa enna ARDS non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema full avay avanga eduthuranga
acher okay po avladha